everyone, it's Jen, and welcome back to Monday Updates on a Tuesday. So, I apologize for not getting this up yesterday. I had a busy day yesterday. It was our wedding anniversary, and I knew this was going to be a longer video because I have a lot of things to show you and talk with you about, so I wasn't feeling it yesterday. I didn't want to rush through it, so I figured I'd just put it off for today. So, we're here now. It's going to be a longer video. Like I just said, I have a lot of things, a lot of new books to show you guys. I went to Barnes & Noble over the weekend. Frank got me some things. I got several books in for review. So we have a lot to talk about. So if you want to pause it and get yourself a drink or a snack and then come back, let's do that. I already have my drink of choice. I have my ginger ale. It's not pee. It's ginger ale in a Starbucks cup. So I'll be drinking that. And I also have to take a moment to talk about the awesomeness of my shirt. So, if you guys can see this, it's a sparkly Star Wars shirt. Yeah. So, there's a funny story behind this, actually. Well, maybe not funny, but interesting, I think. So, those of you guys that have been watching me for a while and watch either my vlogs or my Snapchat know that a couple of months ago when it was still cold, I was wearing this one gray shirt from the Pink store constantly. I would sleep in the damn thing, take it off, wash it, put it right back on, and I was always saying, you'll always see me in this shirt, and I was always in the shirt. Well, just so you know, friends, this is going to be the new shirt of the winter, and that's because this shirt is humongous. You can't really see it, but it is so big. It's a 1X, and I had to have it because I went to Kohl's to look for something to wear to go to my brother's birthday party. And I found this on a clearance rack. It was 90% off. The stupid thing was like $6.90 or something like that. I mean, if it would have been a 3X, I would have bought it. So I love it. I wear it all the time when it's like a little chilly at night. And I will be wearing it through the winter. So expect to see me in this regularly. But on to the books. So the first thing that I finished this week was The Wonder by Emma Donahue. I loved it, and I'm going to be talking more about it in my reviews that'll be going up tomorrow, so check back if you want to hear my thoughts on it. This is a review book that I got. It comes out today, and I would highly recommend you pick it up, but if you want to see my thoughts first, I do have a written review up on Goodreads. Of course, no spoilers, and I will put my spoiler review up, just a brief few things about my thoughts on it tomorrow, so you can check that one out. And then the only other thing that I read this weekend was a graphic novel. I randomly found this, and I think I was actually lucky to find it. It's Who Killed Kurt Cobain, and it's, I don't know who it's by, but it is a graphic novel, and I enjoyed it, and I will talk more about it tomorrow. There are some things I do want to talk a little bit about as far as what I thought about it and what I saw inside the book. This was also a review, and I did like it. I'm a child of the 90s grunge. I totally dressed like Kurt Cobain when I was in the 90s. Believe it or not, yep, I did that. So we will talk more about that tomorrow. But that is all that I read this weekend. So now I'm going to show you the things that I got in for review. And this is The Christmas Town by Donna Van Leer. So you probably can't see my Christmas shelf because it's way up there, but I read all of Donna Van Leer's Christmas stories, and actually I have lent out, I think, 3 of them to my mom right now. I really enjoy her stories, and if you're not familiar with her stories, you might be familiar with either the song or the movie, but she actually wrote the story, The Christmas Shoes, which I stay away from like the plague. I cannot deal with that song. I don't want to watch the movie. I don't want to hear about a mother dying and a kid being left alone to buy her shoes. No, that's not a Christmas story to me. But I will say, all her other stories are beautiful. I've not read The Christmas Shoes because, like I just said, I stay away from that whole thing. But all of her other stories don't seem to be like that. And I love them. So I got this one in for review. I'm really excited to read it. It's a really pretty cover. I don't know if I can really show it to you too well without the glare, but it's about this woman who goes to, she kind of, I think she's like left alone. She has no family and she works in retail, and she just like despises Christmas because of being left alone and stuff like that. And she witnesses a car accident, I believe, on her way home one night from work, and she gets led into this town where, like, everything is over the top Christmas, and I think she kind of finds the spirit of Christmas through that. You know, it's nothing that's going to be groundbreaking. It's a Christmas story, and I love them, so I'm very excited to have that one. Another one that I got, very interesting, found this one randomly on NetGalley. This is called A Daughter's Deadly Deception, and this is by Jeremy Grimaldi, and it's the Jennifer Pan story. So I'm not familiar with this, but I, probably like most of the world, was obsessed with Making a Murderer. Who out there was obsessed with Making a Murderer? I swear, Frank and I watched it in 2 days. 2 days we sat on the couch like sloths and did nothing but watch Stephen Avery, and it was fantastic. And I hear they're making like another whole Netflix documentary about what's going on in his life. My reading's gonna go right down the crapper because I'm totally in on that. And everybody, all my like personal friends on Facebook, have been telling me about this new documentary that's coming on either like today, tomorrow, or sometime, I think in the next week or so. It's another kind of like Making a Murderer thing. So expect my reading to fall off a little bit because, you know, we totally watch it and then we all bitch and discuss about it on Facebook. And if you guys want to do that here, I am so in on that. So anyway, getting back to the books, this is the story of it's a true life story of a girl who, I believe her parents are immigrants from Hong Kong, maybe, and they moved to New York City, and I think she's, like, being very studious and studying and trying to become a pharmacist. And meanwhile, she's spending, like, her afternoons in bed with her boyfriend, and her father finds out about it, and feces hits the rotating air oscillator, and her father's like, oh hell no, that's not happening. And then she takes her revenge on her parents, and apparently she concocts some sort of plot and tries to kill them, or does kill them, don't know, haven't read it yet, we'll let you know when we get there. But I don't think she gets away with it, and I'm sure you could look it up, it's a true story, so you could find out before I even read it. But I think it's gonna be so good, and I hope it's like as intriguing as Making a Murderer. So there's that one. I also got this one. This one's already out, and I didn't think I was going to get it, but then it just popped up on NetGalley the other day. This is Rising from the Ashes by Tony Zioli. It's the true story of a 9/11, what does it say, of 9/11 and recovery team Romero. So basically, from what I could see as far as reading it, is Recovery Team Romero was a group of police officers, I think from the Port Authority, but don't quote me on that one. But it is a group of police officers that went in to do the rescue and recovery mission on 9/11. So, of course, I'm super into reading this. It's already out, so I'm not rushing to get through it or anything like that for a review. I don't have any more books to review for the rest of this month, which is great because I have a lot of things that I want to read for myself. Plus, I have my read-along coming up next Friday. Get your books. We're going to start next Friday. But yeah, so I am really excited to have that one for obvious reasons. And then the last ebook that I got for review was this one. This is Shadowbawn, and this is a novel by Steve Erickson. So for those of you guys that watch Steve Donohue, this probably is going to look familiar to you. I saw it there too, and I have been bugging him and asking him if he's read it. He has not read it yet, so I figured I need to request it for myself and read it. It's basically a futuristic fantasy type story, which is not something I usually read, but it's about the Twin Towers. After they're demolished, they show up in some, they like appear in some South Dakota, I was gonna say something rude, but let's just say South Dakota town. I was gonna curse, but I'm not going to. They show up in some weird town, basically. I don't even think it's a real town. I think it's just something made up. And when people walk past them, they can hear music playing, and some people think they can see someone up in the towers, and the someone up in the towers is some sort of twin that was stillborn. It sounds weird as shit, but it's Twin Towers, so I need to read it and see how weird it is for myself. I don't know if I'll get through it, I don't know if I'll like it, but I will let you know when I get there. So that is what I got for review, and then I did buy two books on ebook. I was lucky enough to look through my list, which is what I do regularly, and I found this one on sale for $2.99. This is The Girl with All the Gifts by M. R. Carey. And I don't know what the spoiler is in it, so I'm not even going to talk about it because, well, duh, I don't know it. But, of course, I do think it's some sort of zombie story. That is as much as I've heard about it. It's a big book. I've seen it in the store. So I think they're turning it into a movie. These days, being a parent of a 20-month-old, I have no worries about trying to read something and get to the movies first because I am never getting to the movies, so I'm not worried about that, but I would like to read it before it comes out on DVD and I could buy it and watch it, so I'm really lucky that I got that one because that's one I've had on my list and it's going around BookTube. And then another one that I got was this one that I saw on Charlie's channel at Duvet Day Devours. And this is called When They Fade. And this is by Jen Roberts. And that is a very interesting way of spelling Jen. I've never seen that like that before. Anyhow, this is the story of two girls. One of the girls is having or had an affair with her teacher. The other girl knows about it. One of the girls dies. I don't know if it's that particular girl that comes back, but some sort of a ghost comes back and tells the living girl, who's now been outcasted because of whatever reasons, that she's going to die, she's going to be alone, and it's going to hurt. And it's all kind of crazy stuff. I urge you to go read the synopsis. It sounds really good. Charlie's been raving about it. She's been really enjoying it. As she always says, it sounds right up her avenue or right up her street or something like that. And it sounds up my street too. So I'm going to put that on the list, I think, for October. I don't know. I have that coming up. I might read it before since I don't have any other review books for this month, but I'm looking forward to that one. Okay, so I did get a few more review books in, and these are not coming out until, let's see, one is November and one is January. So I'll show you the November one first. This one is My Sister Rosa, and this is by Justine Larbalestier. Whew, that was hard. I probably said it wrong, but it's as close as I can come to it. So this one has a really interesting synopsis. It's short, and I'd like to read it to you so I don't screw it up. What if the most terrifying person you know is your 10-year-old sister? 17-year-old Aussie Chi Taylor loves his younger sister, Rosa. But he's also certain that she's a diagnosable psychopath, clinically, threateningly, dangerously. Recently, Rosa has been making trouble, hurting things. Chi is the only one who knows. He's the only one his sister trusts. Rosa is smart, talented, pretty, and very good at hiding what she is and the violence she's capable of. There are parents whose business takes the family from place to place brush off the warning signs as Rosa's acting out. Now they have moved again from Bangkok to New York City. Their new hometown provides far too many opportunities for Rosa to play her increasingly complex and disturbing games. Alone, Chi must balance his desire to protect Rosa from the world with the desperate need to protect the world from her. So that sounds really good. This is already out in the UK, I believe, and I requested this from the publisher, and they sent me a copy very kindly. Thank you so much. I'm really looking forward to reading this. My friend Elisa here on YouTube, she has a channel. It's called Paper Bits. I will link it down below. She read this. I believe she ordered it from the UK, and she raved over it. So when I saw it was coming out here in the next few months, I wanted to get it, and I'm really looking forward to reading that. And then the other thing I got just yesterday was this one. I wanted this so much. This is Under Rose-Tainted Skies, and this is by Louise Gornell. Is that so pretty? What a pretty arc. I can't believe that. And this has a really small synopsis, too, and it just sounds really good. So, her groceries sit on the porch, but her agoraphobia and OCD keep Nora from stepping outside. Trying to snag the bags from her doorway, Nora meets Luke. He's sweet and funny, and romance blossoms, but Nora fears she's being selfish. Doesn't Luke deserve a normal girl, one who isn't so screwed up? Poignant and refreshingly humorous, this tale about hope and self-acceptance combines an appealing romance with a wry, insightful view of mental illness. So I think it sounds really sweet, and typically I don't like too many things about mental illness, although a lot of the books in this haul have to do with that. Interesting. But anyway, I kind of drew like I don't even know what I want to say. I kind of just got something out of this book where a lot of times, just because it's a mental illness doesn't make it really any different from somebody that has an illness. And I have a chronic pain illness. And so many times over the years, because I got this unfortunately 2 months after Frank and I got married, and I've had the fibromyalgia since then. And so many times I've come to the same conclusion. Doesn't Frank deserve somebody that's normal? Like, because we are young and, well, sort of. We're young. And, I, over the years, have really thought, like, doesn't he deserve somebody that doesn't have an illness, that isn't tied to being in bed so much? And, when I read the synopsis, it just spoke to me. So, I'm interested to see how it comes out. I know Frank doesn't feel like that at all. He's never, ever said anything like that. And I know he would rather live with me if I had to be bedridden, as long as I was here to talk to him and be with him, and love him. That's all he really wants out of life. And I know that, but when you're the person who has the illness, it's something that I think is a regular and, a thought that most of us do have. Wouldn't somebody rather have someone that's lively and energetic? So, really looking forward to this one. Doubt that I'll be able to wait till January or even till the end of December to read it. I'm probably going to read this one soon because I've really wanted this one. Okay, and then on to the books that, what will I show you? I'll show you the two books that Frank brought for me. So you might have seen these on Instagram. He stopped off on his way home. He's so cute. On Saturday, he had to work, measuring a house. And he stopped off at, he saw an estate sale, and he stops now to see if they have any books that he thinks I might like. And he found some. So he found me this really old Danielle Steel. This one is Daddy, and this really old Danielle Steel, and this one is Lightning. And I haven't read either one of these. And it was really nice actually, because when he stopped, he didn't know this information, but the person that was selling these was selling them from an estate from someone that died, but he was selling things in order to pay for the funeral of the person that died. So the money that Frank put in went to a good cause, and actually he didn't want to charge Frank anything for the books. He told him to just take them, but Frank didn't want to do that, so he gave him some money towards that. So I'm really excited to have these. I don't remember the last time I read a Danielle Steel book. I do have Rushing Waters, which I would like to get to soon. And it's rather short. It's much shorter than these actually. But I love her books. I used to read her books all the time. I actually got started when I went to Barnes & Noble and started looking through their clearance stuff. Her books were always on clearance for some reason, and I had never read any of her books. And I used to pick hers up regularly. And my favorite one of hers is The Lone Eagle. That one, and is it The House? I think that one might be one of my other favorite ones. I think that was the name of it, The House. It was like a ghost story one. So, really excited to have these. And I have a whole shelf right over here with some Danielle Steel. You probably can't see it, but I have four or five books of hers over there, so I'll be adding these to my shelf. And then I picked up two books from the library. I finished Oxygen, so I returned that one. And then you guys saw I had last week The Thousandth Floor, or whatever the heck it was called. I returned that one. I started it. I couldn't get into it. I never watched Gossip Girl. Somebody told me it was like Gossip Girl in the future, but I've never watched that. I don't know what it's about, and it was just too YA for me. So some YA books, which these other two that I showed you here, these review books, these are YA books, but some of them are just like good old reading. There's no like boundaries. It doesn't, yeah, the characters are younger, but that's really what qualifies it as YA. And some are just too YA for me. Like, I don't get the lives that the characters are leading, and I can't relate to them at all. And that's what I was finding in that book. So I didn't continue on with it. I just read a few chapters and was like, yeah, this isn't for me. So I returned it. But of course, I picked up some other things. So I picked up this one. I've seen this been making the rounds. This is Dark Horses by Cecily Von Ziegsar. Oh, geez. And I believe she's the one who wrote Gossip Girl. So, what am I thinking? But this one actually sounds really good. I picked it up in the library and I read a few pages. The synopsis of it sounds a lot to me like, have you ever seen that movie, The Horse Whisperer? It sounds a lot like it. It's about a troubled girl who gets sent away to try to work out her issues to an equestrian farm, I think it is. And, she meets a horse who also has some like issues as far as like trusting people and being like wild and stuff like that, and somehow I'm sure they're gonna work out their issues together. And I've never read anything by this person. I don't know if she has any other books. Like I said, I've never watched Gossip Girl, but this is not like one of those Gossip Girl things. This is like a deep story, and I read the first few pages and I found myself there in the library, keep turning and turning and turning. I was like, okay, you like this, let's pick it up. So I picked that one up, and I think it's going to be a good one. I think that one's going to work for me. And then another one I saw, I had seen this long time ago when it first came out, and Simon from Savage Reads showed it in just recently in his haul. I think the publisher sent it to him, and it's been out here in America for a long time. But this is Welcome to Night Vale, and this is by, who is this by? Joseph Fink and Jeffrey Craner. So apparently this is based on a podcast. Don't know, haven't listened to the podcast, but I think to me the description sounded very much like the old radio shows, and this is stuff like that my father used to listen to. So back in the day before they had TV, they had these like radio shows where the whole family would gather in a room and they would sit together and it would be like scary stories and stories about aliens and stuff like that. And you know, they'd shut off the lights and it would be like kind of a family thing, and that's what this kind of sounds like. It sounds like it's a story about aliens and government conspiracies and stuff like that, and I really wanted to read it back then, even though I'm not familiar with the podcast, and I just decided, you know what, I forgot all about that. I'm going to see if the library has it. They had it, and I picked it up, so I think this is going to be one of the next ones that I pick up. We'll see. I have like a month before it has to go back, but since I'm lucky enough that I get to not have to do any review books for the rest of the month, and I think nothing's due until like the mid-November. I have that on my list. And then, just two more books. these are things that I picked up from Barnes & Noble. So, oh gosh, it was so hard to get this book. Honestly, I love you people at Barnes & Noble, but if you're going to hire people, you need to get them trained. They don't know what they're doing. I had to ask like three people and then finally get a manager to help me to get this book because nobody knew where to look for it. And it wasn't on the shelves. They hadn't unpacked it. Whatever. Anyway, this is the story of the reader. And this is book one of The Sea of Ink and Gold by Tracy Chi. So I wasn't sure I wanted this. I did want to read it, but I wasn't sure I wanted it until I saw it. And then I was like, we need this. Look at this. Is this cover gorgeous? Oh man, I love it. Even the side, that is going to look so nice on my shelf. So this is the story of a girl who lives in a world where reading is banned. You're not allowed to read. People don't know what reading is or don't know what books are. And her father has this mysterious thing called a book. And he's teaching her about it, and her father gets kidnapped, and she's trying to find out what happened to him. She starts going through this mysterious thing called a book and figuring out what's going on with it and all that sort of thing. And it just sounds so good. It sounds so good. What does it say here? She sets out on a dangerous journey to rescue her... Oh, that's right, her aunt. She goes to live with her aunt, and she has her father's book. Sorry. My synopsis is getting a little confused. And her aunt is the one that gets kidnapped, not her father. And she sets out on a dangerous journey to rescue her aunt using the book as her guide. In the end, she discovers what the book had been trying to tell her all along. Nothing is as it seems, and the end of her story is only the beginning. So I don't know if I'm going to like it. I'm going to give it a try and read it and see what happens. If I don't like it, I won't continue on with the series. But it's a book about books and reading, so I figured, like, how wrong can we really go on this one? And then this is the one that I mentioned to you guys last week that I had in my hands, and I wanted it, and I put it back, and Frank was like, we're going back to get that, and I'm so glad that I did. It's also a YA. I forgot to mention that one is YA, so is this one. This is The Forgetting. This is by Sharon Cameron, and look at this. Is this so beautiful? The story sounds so interesting. It's about people that it's like a town or something. Once a year, they forget everything. Their memory gets erased. They don't remember anything except for this one girl. Her memory does not get erased. What is her name? Nadia, I believe. And they live in the city of Canaan, and life is safe and structured, and all this happens, and then this thing happens called the forgetting, where they forget everything, but she doesn't. And she, you have to keep a book with all of your information in it. And it keeps your identity and the people that you love and all your information in there. And it just, she starts trying to figure out, I'm like stumbling over my words. She starts trying to figure out what's actually happening in this town. And through this, she meets a guy named Gray, I believe it is. Is it Gray? Yes, Gray. And he does forget, though, and she's trying to figure out before the next forgetting happens what's actually happening here and trying to do it so he doesn't forget her. So it sounds so good. I really wanted to read it. You, of course, should look up the synopsis and not just listen to me ramble on here because it's going to sound better than what I said. But you have the general idea. And look at this. Look at this. Oh, I love when they do stuff like that. It says, I am made of memories. And even on the side, it's so pretty. So pretty. Okay, so now that I've gone over that enough, purple end pages. And then I believe when I was flipping through, is that this book? Yeah, look at this. You guys got to see this. Look at this. Look on the tops. Ooh, I love when they do stuff like that. It makes the reading experience so much sweeter. So that is it. That was a lot. I had a lot to show you guys. This is a long video. Thank you for sticking with me, but at least it was a book haul, so it wasn't just me talking about like crap. And I will be back tomorrow to talk to you probably, well, definitely about the reviews and what I'm probably going to pick up next, because I'm not sure I'm free now. I can pick up anything I want tonight, so that's exciting. And also, just want to mention this to you guys, if you've stuck through this long, got this in the mail today, all you members out there, go to Barnes & Noble. There's a 4-day only September 22nd through the 25th member appreciation. This is the second time they're ever doing this. So they did it a few weeks ago and they were successful because when I went in the store, it was packed and they've sent out these mailers. I'm going to post it on Instagram again to remind you guys when it starts. Definitely go because if a book is already 20%, which most of the new releases are already marked down 20%, members are going to save 40%. So guys, do it. Go. It's in store only. And I believe they let you register to be a member that day. It's $25 for the year. I'm not sponsored by this. I just love Barnes & Noble. So let's just put that out there. But Barnes & Noble, if you're seeing this message and would like to sponsor me, we can totally work together. Anyhow, if you have membership, go use it and get your 20% off because it's so worth it. I am going to be hauling this weekend for sure. Hauling my ass to Barnes & Noble to get my discount, and then I'll be hauling my books with you guys probably either Friday or Monday because I think I'm going to go Thursday night. I have a busy weekend planned for my brother's birthday and some other stuff we have to do, so I don't think I'll be able to go on Saturday or Sunday, but I'm going Thursday, so I'm going to get me some books, and I'll be showing you guys those books, so there's that. So that's all that I have for this video. I will be back tomorrow to talk to you about those reviews. So come back and join me. And that's it. So guys, thank you for joining today. And as always, happy reading.